Blog Talk Radio.
Every breath you take, every move you make, every bond you break, every step you take, I'll be watching you. Every single day, every word you say, every game you play, every night you stay, I'll be watching you. Can't you see?
Here in sunny Florida. This is Off the Chain. I am your host, Yvonne Mason. And I'm going to tell you what, I thought I left the Arctic tundra when I left Georgia, but apparently it decided to move further south. If it doesn't hurry up and get warm down here, I may move to the northern part of Georgia where it's warmer there than it is down here. But that being said, I want to welcome to all of you all to our show tonight. That was Every Breath You Take, sung by Celtic Thunder. And, you know, this show absolutely has its own life form. I think I've reached 87,476 listeners. Now just sit on and think about that for a minute. 87,476 listeners in over 100 countries. And in Australia, I love you to death. You guys are my biggest listening base with 98% listeners out of Australia. And because of that, it is such an honor to promote the Teskey Brothers, which is your blues band. And ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't heard the Teskey Brothers, you need to go look them up. Because if you wrap up Johnny Lang and Eric Clapton and B.B. King and Otis Redding and Robert Johnson and put them all into a package, you've got the Teskey Brothers. Those guys should be on Bourbon Street and not down under because they are absolutely amazing. Go check them out. Now, if you want to be on the show, contact me at offthechainradio@yahoo.com. And if you are a little leery about being on live radio because maybe you're shy or you just aren't there yet, but you want to get your product, because like I said, we're heard in 100 countries. When you add up the podcast we put the show up on, we have a listening base now of 109,000 plus listeners. Show's not even 2 years old yet. So if you want to get your product out there, but yet you're still kind of leery about coming on the show, go to advertisecast.com and look up Off the Chain. You will see my pricing there. And ladies and gentlemen, it is very, very reasonable. I will run your ad for a month from the day that I get it, because I believe in paying it forward and promoting other people. That is very important to me. And if I do 20 shows in a month, your ad will run 20 times. If I do 30 shows in a month, your ad will run 30 times. It runs for exactly 1 month. And with that being said, I want to tell you a little bit about a young lady who's placed an ad with me. Her name is Cece Chamberlain, and she has her own podcast called Inside Your Life with Cece at www.podcast.com/Inside Your Life with Cece. She has a podcast. It's full of thought-provoking interviews and motivational and inspirational, she says, to inspire others and to lift up your soul. She has feel-good stories and conversations to strengthen the mind, body, and the soul. Inspiration and motivation sometimes is few and far between for many of us. However, Inside Your Life with Cece podcast is the glimmer of hope in a world full of confusion, discouraging times, or just tough days. And ladies and gentlemen, we all have them. Cece's interviews will entertain you, uplift you, and bring absolutely the best out of the world. So go to www.podcast.com/ Inside Your Life with Cece and check her out. I was on her show the other night, and it was an absolute hoot. Now, tomorrow night, ladies and gentlemen, at 9 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time, on the Investigation Discovery Channel, there is a show called Married with Secrets. I will be on that show tomorrow night. We'll be discussing Gerard Schaefer and how he got away with women. He killed me. He was married. He had secrets. Even his boss, the sheriff of Martin County, which is the next county down from us, did not know what he was doing. Schaefer killed between 9 and 35 young women between 1969 and 1972. And if you have time, go and order the book Silent Scream, because that talks about 9 of his victims, 3 of which I can't talk to tonight. We're discussing tomorrow at 9 o'clock. We have done all of that housing. I want to introduce my guest, who has been so patient and has waited, it seems like forever, to join me tonight. And this woman has a story to tell, I'm going to tell you. Author Linda Tillis was born in Appalachia, Goody, Kentucky, to be exact. And, you know, that's coal mining country. Her mother had a click in the aisle when she was a small child. Linda had the best of both worlds. In the summer, she ran barefoot through the mountains, drank completely. Well, and yes, she even used an outhouse. During the school year, she attended concert galleries. Sadly, she had cancer when she was 10 years old and moved yet again. She moved to Florida to live with her father and his new family. She read vicariously during her high school years. In fact, at lunch on Thursdays, she would make a couple of dollars writing book reports for others. Now, that's a friend to have. Linda worked in the garment industry for 18 years. Then she did a complete 180 and changed careers in 1986. She really changed careers. She got completely out of the garment industry, and so she went from fashion, ladies and gentlemen, to forensics. She spent the next 20 years with the local police department as a CSI. After some years of brutality, death, and general mayhem, her wonderful husband helped her realize it was becoming detrimental to her health. So she retired. She then spent a year reacquainting herself with the real world, not the world of the dead. She took up nature photography and sold a couple of articles with photos to the Florida Wildlife Magazine. Then her husband said, well, now that you've done that, you should write a book. So she did. The story of the Hinton family saga will warm your heart and renew your beliefs. So welcome, Linda. I am so glad you are here.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I'm really happy to visit with you tonight.
Well, it has been a journey for the two of us. I'm going to tell you, you've been forever. I know you think you'll never come. Bless her heart. I think I scheduled for one, and my husband had emergency surgery, and we had to reschedule her. So this lovely lady's been waiting forever. Tell audience, because you have such a storied history, you could write your own story, and it would really be a thick novel. How did you?
Well, a lot of my life experiences are in that first book. I was the heroine in the first book, which is A Heart Made for Love. Lost her mother when she was 10, and she became the caregiver for her family. And so that was a natural segue for me to begin the story that way. That was something that I knew about. And then she is accosted by several men. The book is set in 1890 in rural Florida, and at the time, young May is 16 years of age when she is accosted by some men. Her father and her brothers were at the sawmill working, and the story is how she survives this attack and how she turns it to good. She had a good Christian upbringing by her mother, and while she is recuperating from this attack, she decides that this is an opportunity for her to help other women who have had similar things happen to them but do not have the support of a loving family like she has. And so she decides that she is going to build a place for women to come to where she can teach them a job, get them an education, let them recuperate, and be able to go out in the world and take care of themselves. And as we all know, life does not run smoothly, so there are several bumps in that road, and there's a murder in there somewhere, and of course, that came from my work with the police department. You know, after 20 years of doing CSI work, you're going to write a book, you've got to have a murder. So,
oh, absolutely.
But the book is, it's a good basis for not letting things overcome you. It teaches you to make the most. I mean, if something's happened to you, it's happened. Now, you can, as some people would say, you can wallow around in the pigs with it, or you can pull yourself on up out of the ground and move on. It's not easy. But I have witnessed women after 20 years in law enforcement. I have witnessed women who were able to do that. And unfortunately, I've witnessed a lot of women who were not able to, and they would just kind of float through life from one catastrophe to another because they were unable to bring themselves up to a level of strength that they could break loose from it.
Well, Your life has its own special spin on it. How in the world did you started out in the fashion, in the garment industry, and that's a hard industry within itself. Then you went over to forensics, which anybody that has been on that side of law enforcement, it's a 24/7 job, and it's not pretty. It's really not pretty, ladies and gentlemen, because there are things that one has seen that one cannot unsee. How did you get started in the garment industry? What made you go there to begin with, and what made you do that 180 and go into forensics?
Well, in the town that the big town, you know, back in the early 70s, late 60s, you had your big towns and then your little small ones outside. Well, I lived in a little small town that had a stop sign, and that was it. We didn't even have a traffic light. And so, and attended the local high school. And for me to go to work after high school, I was going to have to drive about 16, 17 miles into the big town of Ocala to find a job. And I had taken 4 years of home ec in high school. There was a garment manufacturing plant in Ocala. And I thought, well, I can sew. I don't know if I could do that or not, but I can sew. So I went and put in an application. I didn't have a car, didn't have a license, had my cousin drive me, and filled out an application, and the lady who was in charge of the floor came over to me and said, do you have time to take a test? And I said, well, yes, ma'am. And they took me inside, and I had to sew some patterns that were drawn on a piece of paper. And she said, can you start tomorrow? And I said, well, yeah, maybe. I'm going to have to find a ride. And about that time, the whistle blew. It was lunchtime. All these ladies come marching out this door, leaving to go to their lunch hour. And sure enough, here come a girl and her mother. She had graduated high school the year before me, and they lived about a quarter of a mile from me. And so I ran to the parking lot and asked them if I paid them, would they let me ride to and from work with them? And that's how I got started there. And I worked for 9 years on the sewing floor. I did what they called side seaming. You uh-huh. would grab up a lady would lay down a bundle of 1, 2, 3 dozen garments down beside you, and you would pick it up and start at the beginning of one sleeve, sew down to the armhole, then all the way down the side of the dress, and then turn it around and sew back up the other side. And you threw it over a bin in front of you, and somebody would come along and gather them up and tie them up and carry them on to the next operation that had to be done. The girl behind me would sew in sleeves, and then she would slide that garment right down a little chute, and I'd just reach over and pick it up, and I would do the sewing up of the side seams, and then it would go on to the next operation. Well, I did that for 9 years, and I was pretty faithful on the job, never sick, never late. And my supervisor put my name in for a new position that they were creating, which was assistant to the production manager. And they chose me for that job. Now, there are people who think that I have an accent. And so I was having to deal with a lot of people out of New York. I had to deal with all of the accessories people, buttons, zippers, threads, all of that. I had to deal with all the designers that were sending patterns and things to us. And my boss thought it would be a good idea if I learned a little better speech pattern. So he sent me to some Dale Carnegie classes, hoping that it would help. I had a really good time. Learned a lot about public speaking, but as you can tell, it didn't do a darn thing for the accent.
I tell folks, you can take the girl out of the South, but you can't take the South out of the girl.
Can't take the South out of her mouth, that's for sure.
No, you cannot. It's part of our DNA, and in no matter where we go, no matter where we live, we could probably live on the moon, and we'd still talk like this.
We would sound just like we sound, I know.
Exactly.
But I did that job for another 9 years, and that was about the time that all of manufacturing was leaving the country. We were the only manufacturing sewing factory in Central Florida or North Florida. There were a few in Miami, but we were the only one up here. We were the second largest employers of women in the county, with the exception of the school board. But I could see the handwriting on the wall. It was getting more and more difficult for them to get work into us, because most places could ship their fabric, their patterns, all of their trims overseas, pay to have the garments made and pay the shipping to come back and come in with less than they would have to pay us to do it here. And it was just a matter of time.
And Linda, what folks don't realize, because I worked in a jean factory for a while, and what people don't understand is when someone works in a, we used to, in Georgia we called them sewing plants. When you worked in a sewing plant, you worked based on piece. In other words, you get paid by minimal salary, minimal by hour, but you were also paid by the piece. And if you didn't produce, your paycheck reflected it. So you had to get the product out as well as get the quality out and still get it out the door by the deadline. That, ladies and gentlemen, is very hard work. Right, Linda?
It was nonstop. The girls on the floor, now they made good money for the time. But they had a 10-minute, they started at 8 o'clock in the morning. They had a 10-minute break. And then they had an hour for lunch, and then they would stop at 5, unless, of course, we were trying to get something on a truck, and God bless them, they would be willing to stay and work overtime. But it you had to move nonstop. You were right. They're paid by the piece, and it's just not a pleasant thing. And I could see that it was slowing down, and they were having more and more difficulty getting work. And I thought, well, you know what? I'm going to get out now. I'm going to find another job while I've still got one. And so my brother had gone to work for the county as a deputy. And I said, well, I can't go to work for the sheriff's office, but I could go to work for the city police. So I put in an application and went to work as a dispatcher. And I did that for about 9 months, and then they decided that they would start training civilians for their crime scene investigators because they didn't have to pay me as much,
right?
As they would a certified police officer with arrest powers. So I always had someone on the scene with me, unless, you know, we got to the scene and it was just like a burglary or something like that and there were no suspects in the area, then the officer could go to his car and do his reports, or he could take off to another call if he had to. I was never alone, alone. And then, of course, on big cases, there was always somebody there with me, homicides and things like that. And it was an exciting but frightening time in our city. I went to work for them in 1986, and that is just about the time that cocaine hit the streets.
Yep, the cocaine cowboy.
And it was every weekend there was a shooting. There would be a shooting this weekend, and then the retaliatory shooting would be the following weekend. They wouldn't tell us anything. We couldn't make an arrest because nobody saw anything. But then the next weekend, the other folks involved would be shot at or shot and killed. And it was that way for about 4 years before they got it under control. It was the mess. But like I said, it was an exciting time. I learned incredible amounts of things. Like you said, there are some things that you cannot unsee. They're stuck in your mind, and after about the boy who trained me, he was a corporal. He had been a medic in Nam, so you can imagine the kind of things he had seen. And he had done this crime scene work for 10 years, and he told me, he said, Linda, I've got to get out. He said, nobody should ever do this for 10 years, and I did it for 20. And so bless my husband's heart, he was the one who I would come home and I would be all uptight and stressed out and going on about what had happened. And he finally told me, he said, honey, you really need to think about getting out of this because you've got in your 20 years now and it's slowly killing you. And I had never really, you don't stop and think. You just go to work every day,
Mm-hmm.
And so I got on out, and the very first thing he did for me was buy me a really nice camera and say, now, go out and take pictures of living things. And it was amazing.
And the thing is, spent 20 years of your life, while it was traumatic in itself, it taught you so much about the real world that most people only see on television and don't understand. This is what happens out there. This, people get killed, people get raped, people get stabbed, people get burned up, people overdose. It happens, and it happens to nice families. It doesn't just happen to the street people
or anything like that.
Right. It happens to all across the board.
Oh yes, and we don't know what goes on behind our neighbor's door.
No, we
don't. That's a good thing. And so you're right. It's across the lines of economics or racial or anything. It's just life. But if you're not in it and you don't see it every day, like you said, you'll see it for a few minutes on the television and you'll say, gosh, that's awful. Well, there are some things that are worse than
And with that being said, let me run this ad. We'll be back to continue our conversation with Linda Tillis, because she put myself as an impact, and that had an impact on her job. So hold on and let's run this ad right quick.
Sure.
Former Boston PD Captain Stanford Carter and his wife, forensic scientist Jill Seacrest, have decided to move to the Big Apple to accept positions with the New York branch of the FBI. Rookie agent Shania Deep Rose completes the trinity as they collide head-on with raging and rampant social, political, and economic unrest amid a string of murders that seem unrelated and may be serial, copycat, thrill, or hate-driven. As they struggle to understand the mind and thought process of the orchestrators, killers, and victims, the team begins to wonder who's who. The line between black and white, superior and subordinate, right and wrong, and good and evil disappears as they are forced to reevaluate their own thoughts, feelings, and philosophies. Ultimately, every character must come to their own conclusions to these questions. Is justice ever more important than the law? Is playing God justifiable if it's for the greater good of all? Come along for the ride to see if Agent Carter will decide to stick to being a hunter or become judge, jury, and executioner instead. Find the answers to these questions when you read the new book, The Killing Collective. The Killing Collective is a character-driven story with big characters with depth. They're soul-searching, in addition to the biggest case of the agents' careers. The Killing Collective, available on Amazon in both Kindle and paperback editions. Order your copy today.
Gentlemen, it's a Killing Collective by Gary Starter. Go to Amazon and you will be able to find it. We are back with author Linda Tillis. I am your host, Tom Mason. This is Off the Chain. And we were discussing Linda's 20-year career as a CSI. And ladies and gentlemen, what you see on the TV is not what you see in real life. And right before the break, I gave him a little Easter egg. Did you like myself impact, Linda? How difficult was it to put that wall up so that you did not feel all of that energy?
Well, I'll tell you what. That's interesting because I've always been what they call a goody two-shoes. I've just been a meek little woman who minded her own business and didn't drink, didn't smoke, didn't go out and party on the weekends. And while everyone at work loved me, they just kind of, you know, thought I was a little odd. And when I applied for the job, I had just become a single mother with three kids, and it was going to be a little bit of a pay raise for me, so I really wanted to get the job, but I just wasn't sure I'd be able to do it. Well, I had put in my application, and I was working night shift, and one night about 3 o'clock, we got in a call of a suicide. And I called the sergeant and asked him, could I respond to the scene with the officer just to see if I could handle this. And he said, that's a good idea. He said, I'm going to have one of the boys come pick you up, and he'll bring you out there. Well, when I got there, he told me, he said, now, we've got Boyd. That was one of the gentlemen who was working forensics at the time. He said, when Boyd gets here, he said, we've called him out. When he gets here, I want you to go in as his assistant. And whatever he tells you to do, you just do it and help him measure and things like that. And I said, okay. Well, now, I came from inside the comm center where we wore these nice little blouses and skirts and vests, you know. And so we get there, and an elderly gentleman had shot himself. And he had fallen alongside the bed just inside the doorway. And when Boyd got there, he just stepped right over the body, went right in the room, started taking pictures. And I stood at the door with a clipboard in my hand just waiting. And I would have to look at the body and then look away. And then look at the body and look away, because I had to absorb it slowly. And Boyd said, okay, Linda, I need you to come over here and hold the end of this tape measure over there to the corner of the wall. And I looked down, and there was no way I could step over that body. I hiked my skirt up, stepped right up in the middle of the bed, and crawled over the bed and went to the far corner. Because I could not bring myself to do that. So I helped at the scene, and they took me back to the station, and I went home, and I went right to sleep. And when I woke up the next morning, the first thing I thought was, oh, my God, that was a real person, and they were dead, and why did I not get upset? Because, you know, that was sad. And I spoke with my sergeant about it, and he said, you were able to do what you needed to do. You were able to not look at the sadness and you know, the pain the family was in. You were able to do the job that needed to be done. He said, I think you're going to be able to do this. And that was very encouraging for me. And God knows there were a lot of things much, much worse than that that came up over the years that I was able to handle. There was only one time that I was not able to handle it, and that involved a small child.
And, now, my husband said the same thing. My husband was the chief. He's seen suicides, he's seen murders, he's seen decapitations, he's seen bodies that committed suicide, hung for 3 or 4 days, and you know what, when that happens,
before
the body is found, and said the thing that he never got over.
If there's a child involved, it hits everybody. And in fact, that was the first debriefing that our agency ever had. There was a small child killed by a couple of Rottweilers, and everyone who was involved, we had to kill the dogs to get to the baby, and everyone who was involved was affected. So it's not like any of us needed to feel like, you know, we're not capable of doing our job. It was a collective need to debrief and discuss. So, and that was a learning experience, and you move on. But having done all that for so many years, my husband was very wise when he told me to get out.
It was time, because you had seen more than enough, and it was time to know that what you saw and experienced defined you. It was the defining, but it did define who Linda Tillis is, because there's more to Linda Tillis than being.
That's one of the reasons that I write my books in the late 1800s and early 1900s, because the books have crime in them, but it's easier for me because it's not a contemporary story. It's not set in today's time. And so it's like I have separated myself 100 years from the real crime, you know? So it was easier that way for me to tell the stories. My books are not graphic because not everybody wants to read or hear about that, but there are some moments. Again, there's a rape, obviously, but I don't go into a lot of graphic detail about it. You know exactly what has happened through the story, but I want everyone to understand the emotional side of it, not so much the physical side of it.
Well, and I think it's important to inundated with graphic. I don't think that we need the graphic because our imaginations are vivid enough.
The act itself is so violent that you don't need the words to describe it. If you can feel the pain of the victim, then you don't need to have a full-blown description, a blow-by-blow of the event. It's just knowing what it's done to young women. And I came across a lot of young women who had been abused, raped, beaten. And so it was cathartic for me to write these books.
You remember the old Alfred Hitchcock movies? That was some of the most horrific horror movies I've ever seen in my life. But you never saw the actual violence. It was all implied. In fact, Janet Lee said after she finished the movie Psycho that shower scene stayed for so long inside her. She had trouble taking a shower because the visual in her head was worse than any visual that they do. They're stupid effects and special effects.
Oh, I can understand that. I can understand that. And I think the main story that I wanted to get through in my books was that you can get through this.
Yes.
You know, it's not you. It's an act that was done to you. And you can walk away from it.
And it's not your fault. It's not the victim's fault.
Exactly.
And when the victims decide they don't want to be victims anymore, and I am a survivor of domestic abuse. I refuse to be a victim because as long as I keep saying I'm a victim, then my abuser still has control over my emotions and my heart, my soul, my life, my mental, my spiritual. He doesn't have control over me. I am a survivor. I came out on the end, and I tell people I want to thank him for that. And I know that sounds stupid, but I want to thank him for the 18 years of abuse because I am the person I am today in spite of those 18 years of abuse.
Exactly. You were able to step up and step out. And I like that premise. In my book, this young lady realizes that there are women out there who need assistance, who just need a place to crawl inside themselves, do a little soul searching and spiritual repair, and then prepare themselves to go back out into the world. And she realizes that she was fortunate. I had a lady who read for me as I was writing the book. I would send her a few chapters at a time. And there is an old country doctor in the first book, and he sets her down after the event and explains to her in terms that anyone could understand that this is not your fault. This is something that was done to you, and it has no reflection on you whatsoever. And I had the lady tell me, she says, I cried, and I thought, oh, if I could just find a doctor who was that compassionate. So I think it was a pretty good choice for the doctor. But
and you're right, when you can move, when you can have emotional output, you've done an excellent job setting that scene and putting readers in that scene.
It's had some pretty very good reviews from everybody who's read it. I don't think anybody has disliked it. I think it's a good combination of excitement and mystery, and there's just a streak of paranormal in it. I don't want to give anything away, but the younger brother has not quite let go of his mother's spirit yet. So, but that's all I'm going to say about that. But it's got a lot of really good, strong characters in it, characters that you can come to love as you read the book. And she finds love, and her father finds love. And so, you know, you got to have a happy ending. All my books have to have happy endings because that's just the way I like my life to be.
Now, you have A Heart Made for Love. What's the name of the you have out?
The Heart Made for Love is the first one. And then the second one is A Man with a Pure Heart. That is the story of her younger brother who becomes very involved. He is so stricken by the fact that this happened and he was not there to protect her that he becomes very protective. And he just watches over her constantly. And he, in the second book, he is now a grown man and is working for the local sheriff's office because he became very involved in solving the murder that occurs. And he, like I said, he had just a little bit of an insight there, but he's gone on to be a deputy with the Leon County Sheriff's Office. And he, in the second book, A Man with a Pure Heart, he has to solve his own murder and finds his own love. Both of those books, the first book was dedicated to a women's shelter in Valdosta, Georgia. It's the Georgia House of Hope, and they take in women who have been abused or who are drug addicts, and they do an absolute wonderful job of rehabilitating these women through the work of God. And that was the first dedication. The second book is dedicated to law enforcement, period. I obviously have tremendous respect for them. Everything that they do on a daily basis just is always incredible to me. The third book, which is not out yet, it's with my editor right now. It's called A Heart for All Time. And there's a little bit of time travel in it. It's about a young woman who is a 911 dispatcher in Greenville, Tennessee. And she went through a marriage to a police officer when she was very young. And he, as often happens, got caught up in what he was doing and started running around. And so she came to a divorce. And she, her parents had died when she was very young, and she was raised by her aunt and uncle. And they have now passed away, and she's alone. And so she has thrown her whole life into her work. She loves her work, and she's highly decorated for all the wonderful things. I don't know how familiar your listeners are with 911 operators, but here in the state of Florida, they're certified, and they can deliver babies over the phone. They can treat gunshot wounds. They can give you CPR over the phone. I mean, they're just incredible. And so this girl is one like that. She's able to do just about anything. And so she's been working herself to death, and they finally made her take some vacation time. And she went antique searching, which is what she likes to do on her off time, and she found a piece of Cherokee Indian jewelry and had no way of knowing that that jewelry was going to take her back in time.
Interesting.
She ends up back in 1890, and I don't want to tell too much of the story because it's a good one, but she travels to and from a couple of times before she gets her life sorted out. But it's a very interesting story, and she's able to use her knowledge that she's gained from being a 911 operator to help save her life and others while she's back in the old days.
And so, what is the name of this book?
That one is going to be called A Heart for All Time.
And is it going to be in print?
Oh, yes, ma'am. They'll all be in print, and they'll all be available. The first two are already available on Amazon. The first one, A Heart Made for Love, is also available in audio on Amazon. And the second one is being put on audio even as we speak, A Man with a Pure Heart. That will be Samuel Hinton's story. And it's available on the audio as well.
When is it going to be released?
I beg your pardon?
When will the third book be released?
I'm hoping for the end of April. It's with my editor right now, and then when I get it back, you know, we'll have to go through that, doing the galleys and everything, but hopefully it'll be out in April.
Well done. Now,
well,
you've got the wings. What have you coming up? No, you're not starting with three books.
Oh, no. I'm already working on a fourth one.
Even
yeah.
Now, would it be fair to say that women in your books are strong women, even though they've had trials and tribulations in their lives?
They don't know how strong they are until they have to be. And then once they have to be, they find that they can do what they need to do to survive.
Could that be said, Linda, for an no, because I was raised by strong Southern women, and the women in my ancestors were strong Southern women, and they did not know how DNA. It's not something that one can be taught, because I've seen some strong women that fell apart in a crisis, but I've seen other women who didn't know they were strong until, like you said, it came down to the fact they had to be.
Yes. I don't think... It's, you know, I don't want to say that it's something that not just everyone can do. I don't understand it because I've seen women a little quick lesson here. I had an officer call me to a scene, a young woman who was in her late 20s. She had been badly beaten, but she had on long sleeves and long pants, and when I got there, the officer said, look, I've got him in the back of the car, I've got to take him to the jail, but I really need you to get pictures of her. She wouldn't let me take any pictures. He said, you really need to talk her into letting me have some photographs, and I said, okay. So I go in the house, and I talk with her, and I had her roll up her sleeves and let me see, and she was really bruised, and I had her convinced to let me take the photographs when the phone rang. She picked up the phone, and she started talking, and I thought she must be talking to a family member or something. And then all at once, I realized from her conversation, it was the man who had been arrested, and he was calling her from the jail. He used his first phone call to call her.
Yep.
I immediately got on my radio and called the officer and said, get him off the phone. And then she would not let me take pictures. She and it wasn't that she was scared. She just wouldn't let me do it. It took me another 45 minutes working on her to get her to let me take the pictures. Well, when it come time for him to go to trial, she disappeared. She left because she just couldn't testify.
When someone is in that kind of relationship, things happen. They call the cops because they want help, but then when the cops get there, they realize that no matter how bad it was before, when he gets out, it's going to be a lot more worse because he's going to be pissed off.
And by the same token, we worked a case where a young woman, the guy was just, you know, she got away from him. She moved out. And he came to her work. She was a waitress at a nice restaurant in town. He came to her work one night, pitched a fit, and some of the boys in the restaurant took him outside and held him till we got there, and they took him off. And she moved. She was so scared that she moved to Orlando. he killed her 3 weeks later in Orlando.
Yep. They did
so,
that.
You know, you just never know.
And women can't, after a woman's been beat down emotionally, mentally, and physically in this relationship, they feel like there's nothing left to fight with. In my case, I made up my mind, what's he going to do, kill me? Well, he already almost has. And we're all going to die sometimes. So I'd rather go, if he's going to kill me, he's going to kill me standing down on my own 2 feet, children, for the rest of my life. He's got good enough to kill me. He's gonna look me in the eye, and he's going to kill me standing on my feet.
Yeah.
And to this day, I believe that because they're bullies.
Exactly.
And when women
take
victims.
Go ahead.
When women use the victim word, that abuser still has the control.
This is true. But I would hope that the message in my books is you can survive, you can have a life, and you deserve. One of the things, the little blurbs that I use for my books is I write stories of women who deserve the love they have to work to get.
Oh, I like that.
Every woman deserves to be loved and loved for herself and treated well. You've just got to be willing to fight for it. You can't give up.
No, you can't. You cannot give up. Now, you're not going to believe this, Linda, but we'll get to the end of our show. I told you, it goes by so fast.
Yes, it would does. And I am so grateful for you letting me come on your show and chat with you and talk about all this. It was great.
Well, honey, this is not a one-and-done thing. You will be a regular on this show because we barely scratched the same things. And I appreciate the fact that you have honored us with coming on the show and talking about yourself because you're the brand. What we sell is a product of our brand. We are the brand. People have you and your books because there's a and where your books can be found.
Well, they can be found on Amazon and thewildrosepress.com. That's my publisher, and the names again are A Heart Made for Love and A Man with a Pure Heart, and when the third one comes out, I'll be sure and let you know about it. But they can go to my website, they can follow me on Facebook, that's Linda Tillis, T-I-L-L-I-S, they can follow me on Facebook, and I'll update everyone as to how the third book is coming along. And again, thank you so much for letting me visit with you.
Oh, honey, the pleasure is all mine. Like I said, when I was doing my DM, I'm going, fashion forensics? Okay, well, now I've been in the garment industry. I know what goes on in the piece work. Forensics? Well, it could be piece or pen.
different kind of pieces, yes.
My mind was working. I'm twisted. I can't help it. You've known me long enough. I have a very twisted mind.
When you've done that kind of thing long enough, it leaves its mark on you.
you have to have a twisted sense of humor to get through the day.
Yes, you do.
So ladies, if she will get a piece of who's in her books, and I know she's going to come back. She already told me she would. She'll get on the show because that's what
happens.
Well,
thank you again.
And don't hang up when the show goes dark because I got some things for you. But
okay, dear. Thank you.
You are welcome. So go and get her books because they're exciting. They're 100 years early, but the excitement and the story and Linda's expertise in forensics and I'm in the garment industry is in this book. Has to be. Tomorrow night, ladies and gentlemen, our guest will be C.W. Thomas. I have not heard from him yet. I'm assuming he knows he's supposed to be a show. That's 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. 9 o'clock, go to the channel and watch Married with a Secret. Now, you have to check your local list for the time zone you're in. Here in the where I am, it's 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. On Saturday night, Author Sarter will be with me. I think he's got a new book or two out. And ladies and gentlemen, tell folks about this show. Send folks to me. I'll interview them. I'm bringing Linda back because I want to know more about her book. And we still got to put this puzzle of the fiction industry and the forensics together. She might could even do a book about forensics and the garment industry. She knows what to do, right?
That would be good.
I see my work for the industry. 1890. Yeah, that could work.
Oh, yeah.
You could do that with no problem. So, ladies and gentlemen, there are several things that I like to talk about at the end of my show, even inspiration and aspiration. And I believe in leaving people with don't just feel special. Be special, ladies and gentlemen. You will never, ever be special because things are fleeting. They come and they go. The difference between who you are today and who you want to be tomorrow is what you do right now. So if you want to be somebody different tomorrow, I suggest you change what you do with your life. And if you don't change what you do with your life, you won't be any different. You will be the same as you are right now. And if you want to achieve greatness, you stop asking permission because nobody will give it to you. People want to keep you down with them and the muck and the mire of despair because they feel low about themselves and they want to. So if you achieve it, it's just going to do it. Believe you are just got it. You know what your quality is after having had an experience. You, ladies and gentlemen, that is your trademark. People will forget your name, they will forget what you like, they will forget what you're with. We'll never, ever, ever forget the way you made them feel. We are on a journey. And sometimes that journey can be very difficult. So if you're in a grocery store line and the person in front of you is giving the cashier a hard time, when you get to the cashier, you tell the cashier she has a beautiful smile or he has a nice smile or they have nice days or a day. Because I've been on that for a while and it's not fun. So wherever you are, if it's a Medicare, if it's a sanitation worker, if it's a cashier at the drug store, it's the repairman, it's everybody behind. It's your children behind. Everybody is traveling a journey and we don't know how to feel on that journey. So with that being said, I'll ask you to join us again tomorrow at 8 o'clock. Author C.W. Thomas, and this is Winston with Off the Chain, and my guest, the lovely, lovely Linda Tillis. Go and get her books and support her. And we want to wish you all a wonderful evening. Please stay warm. I'm trying to because the show will pass. Tomorrow is a new day. So until tomorrow night at 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, this is Yvonne Mason with Off Chain. We wish you a good evening. Okay, we're off the air. Everything that we saying that we'll archive portion of the show and people will be able to hear it. But before we go off, I wanted to tell you that as soon as we get off the air, link up on page unit.
You're breaking up real bad.
It's your phone. Since we're breaking up so bad. Okay.
I'm only getting like every other word. I'll send you an email.
Good night, honey.
All right, dear. Thank you.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye.